to Let's Cook It Up. This is a panel about food. I'm here because I write and co-host Cooking the Books, which is a blog about food and fiction. We do, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
We do all sorts of interviews with, at this point we've got 40 writers up on the website. We talk about food and their fiction. We talk about the grossest thing they've ever eaten. There are lots of different ways to go. Depending if Scott Lynch is a guest, we get him to say maggot
if
cheese.
If only there
Italian.
Was a book that we could use to prop up. The
know, yes. If only,
if
there, was
only
a
there was a
anyone
book.
Here
is Daniel Pinkwater
it's
in
not
your
a
book?
Kindle.
Is Daniel Pinkwater in your group?
Not quite yet. We I have been slowly working my way through. There's a lot of writers that have amazing food in their books.
Yeah, he's one that food is always central.
But the kicker was one of my first interviews was with Joe Haldeman. Joe and Kay Haldeman came on, and I had this whole thing about MREs, and I was researching everything. And my first question, Joe interrupted me and said, "Do you want to know how to make pizza in a foxhole using TNT or plastique?" And I said, "Yes," and threw all my notes away, and we went from there. It was fabulous. So that's how I got started in food. But for the last couple of years, these guys have let me join them on their food panel, and we have had so much fun that we decided that it would be fun for Readercon to do this as well.
It will be short. They're not just animals. That is the world's greatest thing
with plastique.
Oh, with plastique.
Plastique. Apparently, somebody sent them. They were in Vietnam, and somebody from home sent them a pizza making kit. And so they dug a pit, and then if you do plastique correctly, it burns very slow and very hot. If you do it incorrectly, you don't get a pizza. But
usually it explodes. Yes.
Yeah. But it was absolutely.
You don't get a pizza. You get pizza.
Yeah. and it sort of went from there. So my name is Fran Wilde, and I am primarily an author, but because I get nervous around strangers, I decided I was going to talk to other authors about food. You're next. and it's been really fun. It's amazing. It's an amazing topic. It's an amazingly broad topic. It is terrifying when you're writing your own book and you discover that you've made a food mistake in the third draft and you have to go back and fix it very fast because you know people are going to track you down and ask you about it later.
Yes.
So that's me. You want to introduce yourself?
And tell us about the Venn diagram.
Okay, first of all, world's best Venn diagram. Should take too long to figure out.
No, it's perfect.
All right.
Absolutely perfect.
I'm David Shaw. I cook. I blog about cooking, and am generally insufferable on the subject of cooking and science.
He plays with his food.
I play with my food a lot. How many people have been to one of these before?
Oh, that's so cool.
Who's new?
Okay.
Welcome.
Do you have to sign a blast radius waiver?
Where are your groupies?
So I'm Diane Martin. David and I live in Somerville, Massachusetts. We have a house with 2 years worth of music that you can listen to straight through without a repeat. More books than you can possibly imagine. That means nothing at ReaderCon. And an ever-increasingly large supply of cookware. So David loves cooking, and I like cooking too, but I really like baking. We actually, you know, when we moved in together, we signed a mutual treaty, and which is basically I can oversee the baking, and I have final say, and Dave handles the cooking, which is I'm totally okay with. But we started playing with lots of new materials for us. So we're doing things like having Airgas show up with a 150-gallon container of liquid nitrogen. Yeah, they don't like delivering to homes.
You know? It's unusual.
So we've been doing these talks for the people that have been in here to let you know that we're trying these experiments and we want to show you that a lot of these things can be done in your home too.
Worth pointing out that we didn't wind up on a panel with Fran until we all went to another part of the world.
Yes, that's true.
We got thrown together at LunCon and realized that we're all from the States, so we should be doing this more often.
Now, I realize we should have my husband, the chemist, if you follow me on Twitter, the chemist.
That's true.
Because if you give a moose a muffin, you give a chemist a bar set. it has become this magical thing. He just, he has, it's, this could be the perfect mix.
Oh, I think
you guys need to all open up science
fiction. Yeah, I'm very impressed.
All right, so before we get started, I would like to issue the now Bob standard responsibility awards. I like to treat people as if they are adults. You know what you can and cannot eat. We will tell you everything that's in anything that we tell you to put in your mouth. You have to make a decision. We have an attorney here. This is all verified. This is all legal. If you don't think you should eat something, don't eat it.
Oh, yeah.
We couldn't do the, the projector didn't work. We had to wing the talk.
I see.
So,
I don't think I follow directions.
As long as everyone understands the responsibility order, we're going to start out with something. Today is Fran's birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Fran! And so we made sure that it would be memorialized.
When Fran said, we were getting together to talk about what we were going to do on the panel, and Fran said, if it's on Friday, which is my birthday, I fully expect my cake to be in pill form. And so, chocolate cake pills. I'm going to pass this bag around, or actually my, our lovely assistant.
You grab a hand. No. You can grab one side.
Yes, sir.
I'll grab the other.
All right, so. This is a technique that I've used before. I've probably handed out powdered things before.
Take a two in case
so
I read one to one.
Okay.
This is just a supermarket standard Betty Crocker chocolate fudge cake. So the first ingredient is Betty Crocker cake mix. If you know that you can't eat Betty Crocker cake mix, don't. And then it's just eggs, water, oil, and tapioca malted dextrin. And the gelatin capsules are non-kosher. They're made with probably animal hide gelatin, just like the old days.
Who needs one to bring to someone who can come to this camp?
Oh,
I do.
Well, come and get us at the end. We have one. So, first of all, I strongly recommend that you just pop both capsules into your mouth.
No.
Let them dissolve. Don't kind of just bite into them because you'll wind up inhaling a whole bunch of powder.
Is that an instruction to consume?
Yes.
Please.
So
now I'm trying to decide, do I know you well enough that this isn't a David Koresh thing you're recalling?
That would be cool.
The same things in each?
Yes, it's just two of the same because one isn't quite enough for you to get the taste.
Thank you.
So the idea is that you could take any high-fat, low-moisture thing and blend it with tapioca maltodextrin, which is dehydrating, and it turns it into a powder. So you can mix olive oil with maltodextrin and get olive oil powder. I think in the past I've passed out peanut butter powder, Nutella powder. But Fran said, it's my birthday. And I thought, okay, we have this box of cake mix. I made the cake and thought, maybe it's a little too moist, so I cut it up into little cubes, put it in the oven to dry it out like I was making croutons. I made cake croutons, which drove out all the moisture, and then just processed it with an equal volume of maltodextrin. And that's what you've got there, that sort of chocolate cake flavored powder.
And luckily, in your handy dandy organic section of most Whole Foods, you'll find a little pill maker. So you can get gelatin capsules, you put half of the pill in, you fill them, and then you clump them together.
Yeah, people apparently make their own kale supplements. So go to Amazon, you can buy a bag of 1,000 capsules in this little machine.
This is great.
All right. So, while we were in London for LondCon, thanks to the persistent efforts of Scott Edelman, we managed to eat at two restaurants owned by renowned chef Heston Blumenthal.
Oh, my God.
So, we had lunch at the Fat Duck, and then we had dinner at dinner. Lunch at the Fat Duck was amazing. But the dish that stood out for us, and one of the great examples of playing with your food, they had this sort of Alice in Wonderland themed course where they brought out a card that had the section from the Mad Tea Party printed on it. They put these little glass carafes in front of us that had something in the bottom and what looked like water in the top, and handed each of us a, what looked like a gold pocket watch on a teabag string. instructed to take the pocket watch and dunk it into the liquid on the top. Now, in the book, the Mad Hatter is dunking his pocket watch into the tea to make sure that it's working. Of course, it doesn't. But as you dunk the pocket watch in, it's actually gold leaf covering a bullion cube, a bullion disc, which winds up being veal stock. And once it's dissolved, you are then instructed to pour it into the bottom, which is mock turtle soup. Now, turtle soup used to be a big thing until the turtles were almost hunted to extinction. Mock turtle soup, which became the substitute because it was much easier to make, is made with veal. And this is actually a recreation of a historic recipe with a modern presentation that it is indeed mock turtle soup. The reason why the mock turtle in the Tenniel drawings has a cow's head is because he's the mock turtle, therefore it's half veal, half turtle.
And that's recognized the 150th anniversary of Alice in Wonderland.
Yes. And if I may interject about that chorus,
yes.
I, who do not drink alcohol, even though I shared in this and watched the watches being dissolved in everyone else's soup, could not do that. And you could perhaps explain what chemistry is involved in that, that mine had to arrive pre-dissolved because they could not create the watch without the use of raw alcohol or something.
That's
something
right.
Involved with that.
They had to use a, they gave you a different, the reduction in the pocket watch included a port Madeira reduction, which meant that there was still some residual alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
So they gave you a different stock base that they had pre-dissolved.
Right. So I was a witness, but not a participant in that particular. Yes, it was. No.
So at dinner, which is the name of the restaurant, so you can mess with your friends a lot, so we're going to dinner at dinner. They presented this course, and we should step back and say that in addition to being this amazing molecular gastronomical chef, Heston Blumenthal is actually very interested in historical recipes. And actually researched lots of old cookbooks and techniques for a TV series, which you can find on various places on the internet, called Heston's Feasts. So the
really, really, if you're interested in that, please go online, because
yeah.
Not only do you, it is very entertaining, he also takes you behind the scenes, so you can see the research that was involved in teasing out what ingredients needed
yeah.
to be, today's ingredients needed to be modified to actually make this, make the recipe.
I think
it's
if you watch them all on the BBC site, because these are all
for
the BBC. So the mock turtle soup was part of the, one of the courses for Heston's Victorian Feast. This course was from Heston's Medieval Feast. And medieval cookbooks are full of recipes for making these foods that are supposed to look like one thing but behave like another. And in this case, the meat fruit, and M-E-A-T-E-F-R-U-T, I think is the original spelling, meat fruit, that's a piece of grilled bread, it's just grilled bread. But that mandarin orange is actually a sphere of, in the original recipe, it's just whipped chicken livers, but in this case, it is a foie gras terrine mousse wrapped in a skin of mandarin orange jelly.
Hmm.
So you can eat everything on the plate except the actual stem, which is just a plant stem. You just cut into the orange and smear it across the bread. It's amazing. And in fact, in the restaurant, we were at the chef's table, when they're preparing this dish, so you don't get any idea what's going on, they actually pull a curtain over the window while prepping that course, and it just comes out like this with no explanation. It was like, this is the next course. So it's like getting ready to pick up the orange to just, you know, bite into it or to peel it. It's like, no, just leave the orange and use your knife.
I have a question.
Yes.
Since I was not at this dinner. So there was usually an element of surprise, sometimes not so good surprise.
he actually researched he tried to figure out a way to make a pie from which 4 and 20 blackbirds could emerge, and just couldn't make it work without it being severe animal cruelty or something that is truly awful.
I heard you're supposed to freeze them. You freeze the bird and then you cook it gently, and then it will cut something. But that sounds like 4 different kinds of severe animal.
Yeah, there's a lot going on there. In fact, the intro to the Visit Cookbook with the, all these recipes is called Historic Esther Blumenthal. The epigraph at the beginning is a technique for, it's from a Roman cookbook of all things. You know, they present an entire boar's head, but they tell you to leave the esophagus and the trachea attached but hidden so that you blow through it. It actually makes a mooing sound.
Oh my. That would not be fun.
That's for the Christmas dinner, which we have.
Christmas.
So part of the problem with this dish, this meat fruit, is that it tastes absolutely wonderful. It looks really simple, and she who must be obeyed will eat anything that has foie gras in it. We have an annual birthday dinner that I cook for her, and the only mission statement that I have is to top the previous.
Come up with new ways to.
Yeah, she kind of waves her hand and says, "Surprise."
Of course, it's not that much of a surprise because, as anybody knows, cooks, you can't do it by yourself. So there has to be at least 2 people. Sometimes we drag our son in to get involved as well. And this is the reason why you need multiple people.
So this is a very abbreviated version of how these things are made.
What is that?
The thing on the left.
Can you bring the lights down?
Oh, yeah. Open up the panel there. Just for the front, so we can dim the...
Here, it might be here.
Nope, wrong ones.
That's good.
That is a rather large thing.
Right. So the thing on the left is a silicone half-sphere mold. So there's 8 bits. You make a foie gras terrine, pipe it into these molds, freeze it, and then you take a blowtorch and very quickly just melt the very, very top of each of those hemispheres. And you fold the entire thing in half at the halfway point to make each hemisphere attached to the other because they're slightly wet because they're partially thawed. And then they refreeze into perfect spheres.
Hence the need for at least 4 hands.
Where do you get the mold?
Amazon.
Believe it or not, the answer now to almost any question in one of these presentations about where do you get the X? Start with Amazon. Yeah. I have some sources at the end.
There's no midnight raid on the pharmacy.
No. Not anymore. So once they're frozen, you dunk it and you stick a skewer into it. And the thing on the right, this is really difficult to see. I'm sorry about that. It looks great on my computer screen. There's a big metal pitcher which is full of mandarin orange gelatin, which is kept at like 80 degrees, just 1 degree above its natural melting point, because you don't want it too hot. You take these frozen spheres of foie gras terrine, and you dunk them into the gelatin, and you do it 3 times in a row. In between each step, you throw them into the freezer really quickly. And it turns out that the freezer makes the any moisture in the gelatin crystallize around the outside. When you do this 3 times, the final time when you pull it out, that gelatin looks exactly like an orange skin. It's got the little dimples and bumps because of the ice crystals. Yes?
How do you put it back in the freezer without flattening the gelatin?
Good question. If you look behind the bucket there, there's like a white block of foam. You take the sticks.
It's a white block of foam.
You basically have 8 oranges suspended in midair on their skewers.
So you have nothing else in your freezer.
Exactly.
Yes.
I have nothing else in my second freezer.
We knew you had more than one.
Mm-hmm. Right. There are references in the blog to the deep storage facility. That's the refrigerators in the basement.
So that's meat on a stick.
It's meat on a stick. It's a meat pop on a stick with a nice little orange coating. And when, you know.
This is why they bring me along, because I'm really slow. So they have to explain this to me in small words.
And so that's my version. You can actually see the texture on the orange there.
Nicely done.
That's awesome.
And it tastes really good.
Yes.
It worked out very well. I actually but sending Diane to a florist to get the specific, there's a filler plant.
If you want
there's
to
a
be
filler
historical.
Plant that they
yeah.
use for flower arrangements that looks like the orange. And so go to a florist and ask for some ruscus, and they'll just give it to you. Hmm. So,
wow.
That's what.
And how many of these did you bring to distribute?
Well, those we don't hand out. Because it would take me a month to make.
Good try.
Just before you serve, you take your thumb and you push it down to make it look like that little depression at the top of the orange, and then you poke the stem into it. In November, for my birthday, we got a table for one of the last seatings for a restaurant in New York called WD50.
Woohoo!
And it was amazing because during that period of time, it was the best of or their favorite meals that they were cooking the entire time. So you really didn't know what you were getting.
Yeah, it was. That's right. It was the last week before they closed, and they said this is the greatest hits menu. Wiley Dufresne, the chef and the founder of WD-50, became well known for being the guy who experimented with transglutaminase, which we've also referred to before as meat glue. But he has this other dish that he does with the eggs. And it turns out that he had made that recipe available in this obscure site online, which I found. So one of the other courses that was going to be in the birthday dinner was one of the courses we had at my birthday dinner. So what you see on the left is there are little plastic freeze pop bags. You fill them with Kool-Aid or whatever. You clamp them off at the top and you make ice pops out. Those are full of egg yolks that have been cooked sous vide at a particular temperature where the eggs are sort of semi-solid. You can sort of smear them around. They're kind of plasticky. And the things on the right are cubes of hollandaise sauce. And the hollandaise sauce has had like three different hydrocolloids and gelatins mixed into it so that at room temperature, it's solid. And then they're dredged through a standard egg wash and coated with toasted English muffin crumbs. So for service, you actually deep fry those little cubes of hollandaise sauce, which renders the outside crispy and the inside liquid again. And after some clever plating, you get eggs Benedict. So that's the egg yolk that's smeared across the plate, the fried hollandaise cubes, there's little chips of dried Canadian bacon, and a couple of chives just for decoration. So that's our attempt to reproduce the WD-50 dish.
So some of the things that we've mentioned, the hydrocolloids, not the transglutaminase, you have to get that separately. But some of the things that are involved with what's called molecular gastronomy, if you're not quite sure that you want to experiment, you want to invest in it, Edmund Scientifics Online, so scientificsonline.com, if you go into the kids section, they have a Fun Fork food kit for, I think, $13.99, where you get small little containers of some of the things that we talk about, and some pipettes if you want to do some spherification. And it is a really great way not only just to get kids involved, but also you as the cook to see whether or not that's something that you want to try to do in your kitchen. And then if you like it, you know you can just go and buy some of the larger quantities of the material. So I really encourage people to go ahead and try it. You know, a lot of these things could be very expensive, and when they put them in little kids' kits like that, it's really reasonably priced.
And then, of course, we found this, we kick-started this mechanical toy. A blowtorch used in the kitchen is fairly common for doing things like creme brulee and putting a crust on things. The problem with blowtorches is, depending on the gas canister that you use, you can detect what they call torch taste, which is uncombusted hydrocarbons. So, you know, hey, this creme brulee has this little hint of gasoline to it. You don't
what we normal people call yucky.
Yes. So a chef at the French Culinary Institute came up with this idea for basically a blowtorch-based infrared broiler. So it's hard to see because, again, I'm sorry about the projector lighting here, but that glowing spot is a giant wire mesh screen at the end of a big cone. It looks like a giant microphone. So when you activate the torch, what you're basically doing is instead of burning stuff, you're heating it with radiant heat and infrared, like a broiler. So that's just the torch warming up on the left. On the right, and again, I apologize for the projector here, I am putting a crust on steaks that were cooked sous vide. So you cook the steak to like 135 degrees, but of course when it comes out, it's this very unappealing gray. And then you just blast it with the sears on and you get this really nice crust on it. So that's an obvious use for it. You know, the aforementioned creme brulee, also another use for it, but you know, we've begun to discover that we can indeed sear all the things. I know that Scott has finished off his beef briskets with the sears off.
Briskets, steak, short ribs, chicken. We haven't done fish yet.
Actually, fish is really good because you can cook the fish with the skin on, and then, of course, the skin never crisps. By the time the skin crisps, the fish can be overcooked. But if you cook the fish skin up, you can then just blast it.
I've seen people do s'mores with them.
Ooh. You can do soft shells.
Soft shells, exactly. In fact, I want to point something out here. You'll notice that the torch is sitting on a wooden cutting board, but that the actual searing of the steak is on a stove grate with a beat-up old metal sheet pan. You don't want to be searing anything on a wooden surface. Safety first.
Well, then you can sear it from both sides.
And I've discovered that you don't necessarily have to sear the second side, depending on how you're doing your presentation, which means that stuff can come out and still be pretty hot. All right. This is both a story and a boast. This is a dish that I made for a previous dinner. This is a dish that was invented at El Bulli. El Bulli is the restaurant that was in Spain, founded by Chef Ferran Adrià, who's pretty much the godfather of molecular cuisine. He closed the restaurant to much wailing and gnashing of teeth 4 years ago.
Something like that.
Yeah, around 3 or 4 years ago. This one recipe out of all of his recipes had made an appearance in a cookbook that they had put together for some charity. I decided I was going to make this, and it took 2 weeks. Not to assemble it, obviously, it went together very quickly, but clockwise from the bottom, tomato sorbet, cauliflower mousse, tomato ice, basil gelatin, corn mousse, beef foam, almond sorbet, and there's avocado underneath it. So the trick of this dish, not just figuring out how much gelatin to put into the different things and making the different ices of the foams, you have to assemble it at the last minute because the foam gets piped out onto the plate, the sorbet gets spooned out. So you start out with these freezing cold plates to keep everything together. You just have to...
Again, multiple people. Ever see any of the Ebbly movies or any special on TV, you'll see that you know there are five people there putting everything on the plate, and the reason is that because it needs to be plated immediately and then served, or you're just going to end up with a puddle.
Right. So this was a three-person
experiment along the way.
Oh yes.
Yep. So you have sort of test runs.
I tend to make double of something the first time. And then, you know, if it comes out, then I will see, okay, how is this going to stand up on the plate? Do I need to chill the plate? Does the plate need to be warm? Because this is something that a lot of people forget. The temperature of the plate actually changes a lot about how your food behaves. So, having made this, it didn't look quite this pretty. This is the official photo. This is not the photo of my plating, but my plating was sort of close. We're members of the Museum of Science here in Boston. Last year, they opened an exhibit on molecular gastronomy, and it was curated by Ferran Adrià. It was basically a history of the restaurant with these gorgeous photos, and we were invited to the preview opening, which was preceded by a lecture at the museum by Ferran Adrià, who always travels with a translator. And he lectures in Catalan, and the translator speaks in English. So they did the lecture, they had some little molecular snackies for people to try, and we're wandering around the exhibit, and our son is with us, and we're standing in front of this picture, which is in this case, because next to the photo of the final dish was a picture of a plate with hunks of modeling clay on it. It turns out that a lot of chefs will use like Play-Doh and things to figure out what a plating will look like, how relative volumes work out. So we're looking at this, you know, Play-Doh and photo.
And our son taps me on the shoulder and says,
turn around, and there's Ferrandi. I looked at him and I said to the translator, tell him that I've cooked this dish. And the translator goes, and Andrea looked and said, you cooked this dish? I learned two things right there. He speaks and understands perfect English and chooses not to speak as a way to sort of buffer himself. But he looked at me and said, you cooked this dish? I said, yes, I did. And I paused and said, I have a biochemistry degree from MIT. He said, that explains much. And he said, and the timing, I said, I had three people help me play this. Good. Cold plate? Yes, cold plates. So I had successfully done it the way he did it, apparently. And then he said, this is the most important dish in the history of LPU.
Wow.
And walked away after signing our program. And had to look it up later on. It's the most important dish in the history of the restaurant because it's the first time they used like six different techniques on one plate. And this was, having purchased the Elderly Cookbook, which is six volumes like this, each recipe is numbered because every day they make up a new menu. Nothing gets repeated. And so this was a very low serial number recipe. So obviously it was an early attempt.
Like an Erdos number.
Yeah, it's like an Erdos number. Yeah, exactly, the Adria number for food. So that was kind of nice to be, kind of have this experimentation sort of
validated.
Thank you.
I'm just doing a time check right now because I want to make sure that we get to the experiment.
We made it, because having so many different techniques on the plate was such an interesting idea, we stole this recipe from 11 Madison Park in New York City. It's a dish called chocolate and milk. There are eight different preparations of either chocolate or milk here. Bottom right-hand corner, that is dehydrated milk foam. Upper right-hand, the white stuff is liquid nitrogen frozen whipped cream. The upper left is dehydrated chocolate mousse and liquid nitrogen frozen chocolate mousse. There is some caramel sauce underneath, white chocolate sorbet in the middle, toasted milk solids, another, you know, nightmare to assemble, but really cool to put together kind of thing. We're going to actually have some chocolate cake, real chocolate cake, in a moment, which is what the devil box here is for. I'm going to start out by describing or listing the ingredients. So instant chocolate cake. There's eggs, sugar, salt, plain old wheat flour, and semi-sweet chocolate in here. So there might be some dairy. Well, there's some dairy in the semi-sweet chocolate, probably. There's obviously gluten in the flour. You know what's in here. There's nothing else unless you have a particular allergy to nitrous oxide, which I suppose is possible. So in order to kind of streamline the presentation, and of course everybody has one of these. Yes, you all have a foam charger at home, right? Making whipped cream, cocktails, and things like that. Foam tool. That there's batter, this cake batter is in here. And I have two nitrogen cartridges. So I'm going to charge up the cake batter with the nitrogen. Why do you use nitrogen instead of CO2? Because it's inert. It doesn't taste like anything. If you use CO2, it would aerate the batter, but it would become acidic because CO2, you know, club soda is acidic.
Did you say nitrogen or nitrous?
Nitrogen. It's nitrous oxide. Yeah. NO2.
Yeah. I have faith. This is what I want to do with Spire Scouts. And remember, safety first. Our kitchen is definitely fitted with safety glasses, so remember.
I'm just charging. This part is completely safe.
Can
Can I say something? I thought I had the name of that restaurant was WD-50 and not WD-40. I had a bad name.
No, WD-50, which stands for Widely Defrained 50 Clinton Street. And of course, I have appropriate lab gear as well. In the event of explosion, I at least will be protected.
Nice. Nice. Oh, yes, of course.
Chef.
Sure.
And there's also a chef that has barium, cobalt, and nitrogen on it. Take your time, spell it out.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so.
Technically a vegetable.
Yes. This should work. The problem here is because the batter is made in advance, the flour really hydrated while it sat, so I had to sort of whip it back into liquid form again. So what I'm going to do is just take an ordinary paper cup. I'm going to pipe some of the foam into the cup. This is going to be loud, but not dangerous. And it's not going to pipe out because the batter's too thick.
This is the other part of experimentation in the kitchen, failure.
Ah, there we go. This might work after all.
I wonder if you could tweak the recipe so it would work after sitting.
I could, but I haven't. All right, so I've got a cup partially filled with cake batter. Put it in the microwave for...
Oh, good.
There's nothing to see.
There's
nothing to see here.
I can imagine.
This way, when the front blows out, it doesn't hurt the audience.
That's right.
Safety first.
He has his protective apron on anyway.
I didn't hear the pacemaker warning.
True.
Does anybody have a pacemaker?
Everybody in here is far enough away.
I did say something about assigning a blast radius waiver.
Mm-hmm. My sister worked at Burger King years ago when she was in high school, and someone found a way to jam or circumvent the safety precautions on the microwave, and they were letting a microwave just run for an hour, and people would throw things in and out. And this was in Connecticut. Someone walked by and said, "Do you realize you're cooking yourself every time you stick your hand in there?" And they eventually closed the door, but that's, it was very surprising to see that.
So that microwave seemed pretty quiet.
Well, that just means it's not
going to
explode.
It's a little one. It's like a little 700 watt dorm style microwave.
Who
said Quaestron?
The word of the day. Wait. Oh yes, to get more cake.
It's like David and Diane's playhouse.
It really is.
That's right. Yeah, we got it.
There's some people in the back.
Oh, okay. Yes, there's a standing warning against Quaestron radiation. Look at an old electromagnetic spectrum.
Oh, there are new people.
To
repeat the allergy.
Which is what they came up with before microwave. All right, so unfortunately, I'm only going to be able to pass out a little bit of this sample. It's hard to see, but the cake has sort of foamed up in the cup. Because the batter is so thick, I can't just pipe it out and aerate it as well as I thought I could. But the idea is that you can make chocolate cake in a cup. Ferran Andrea's brother, Albert, came up with the technique. There we go. And I honestly think this is a much more difficult recipe than some of the stuff in El Bulli. There is not going to be enough of this to go around, and it is blisteringly hot. But I'm going to cut into little chunks, and people are welcome to sample little bits of it. So while we're doing this, are there questions? I would love to answer questions.
What do you do with all that liquid nitrogen?
Make stuff.
Like what?
Ice cream.
Ice cream.
We should, since there's not enough to go around, we should have a food quiz for who gets to
Oh, that's true.
That's true.
Yes.
Some of this cake will go to whoever asks the best question.
Yes, yes.
And we'll call it.
Okay.
We'll call it the Hunger Games.
What was the worst kitchen accident you ever had?
Wait, blood or no blood?
Inedible.
Having this explode all over the inside of our sink when I was trying to clean it out. Yes.
What's the strangest thing you've ever done with chicken?
Living or dead?
In the kitchen or the bedroom?
I can answer that question. Our son said, I watch the stuff that you do. I want you to figure out how to make deconstructed buffalo wings. And we wound up making a solid 8x8 brick of boneless, skinless chicken thighs that were held together with transglutaminase, cutting them into cubes.
You make chicken ovens?
We made
Margaret Atwood's chicken ovens from
pretty
yes.
much, yeah.
Yes.
And then we made a buffalo sauce powder, a celery puree, a blue cheese foam.
Wow.
And basically, it was all the flavors of buffalo wings, but in separate little unrecognizable bits on the plate. That's the strangest thing we ever
did. Did he like it?
Oh yeah, it was perfect.
All right.
Cool.
All right, that was
an excellent. Oh yeah, have a piece of cake though.
That's
have
right.
Have you ever tried the Professor Lumenthal's experiment where he fed duck blood to leeches and tried to use it to make blood pudding?
Oh, I heard about that experiment. The one that he did that I really wanted to try. He was trying to demonstrate the emulsifying power of a single egg yolk. And he had, it was the strange thing. It's in his backyard in the, behind the restaurant, the picnic table. He's got one of those big plastic laundry baskets that has solid walls with the handles. He throws one egg yolk into it. He and the guy holding the basket are wearing hazmat suits, head to toe. And he has six of those 15-quart restaurant-style containers of vegetable oil. And power drill with a paint stirrer.
Oh, without even asking a question, thank you.
With the paint stirrer while the guy is holding it. And then while the paint stirrer is going, he manages to dump four of the six containers of vegetable oil and make an entire laundry hamper full of mayonnaise. And by the time I got about half
I got
full,
mine already.
Of course,
let the others.
It's going everywhere, hence the hazmat suits. By the time they were done, they were completely covered head to toe with mayonnaise, but they had proven that you can make, baskets full of mayonnaise with one egg.
Yeah. Why, some of my finest nights in college, I was covered head to toe in mayonnaise. Oh, those days, they just come back to me.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
Worst
tasting failure. Wow.
Taste, texture.
We made something where we were following the recipe because we had never seen it before, and the salt ratio was way off, and it was so salty it was inedible. We just took a bite and went, and it turned out, after contacting the chef, that it was a misprint in the recipe. So, like the guy in Real Genius, sometimes, always, check your references.
Now, as a follow-up to that, have you ever poisoned anyone? Not fatally, but I mean, have you ever done something real so wrong that someone got ill?
Intentionally?
No, never.
No, okay.
Never.
What's the easiest strange thing you've ever made?
Easiest strange thing? Strange is kind of an odd word because what I think is strange and what other people think is strange is very different. Easiest strange thing.
That looked pretty easy and strange.
Okay, actually, this is both the I wouldn't say strange, but unusual in that most people don't do it. I've mentioned in a previous talk that you can use xanthan gum as a thickener. And if you use too much, you're supposed to use like 0.1% by volume, and by weight rather. And if you don't, by volume, if you don't, you wind up, instead of making vinaigrette, I put xanthan gum in vinaigrette to keep it from separating. But instead of using a tenth of a percent, I used a percent.
I was never off, got that cruet back again.
I was off by an order of magnitude, and I wound up with sliceable vinaigrette.
That's interesting. You've been very quiet on the subject of cocktails, and I have to imagine there's been some experimentation there.
Oh, yes, yes. This.
Yes. That's why that.
This
that
winds
was
up being a very useful device because you can take this and, for example,
cocktails in pill form.
Not cocktails in pill form, although take a bag about this big, put sliced cucumbers in it along with. Along with some lime juice and some gin. Just seal the bag shut. Throw it in here. And just charge up the container with carbon dioxide, let it sit for 30 minutes. What winds up happening is the gas pressure infuses the cucumber slices with the gin and the lime, which you then use as gin and tonic garnishes. And then, of course, you've got this lovely liquid left over that you can slurp out of the plastic bag, just like in college.
And you have all the equipment with you, so we could do this later.
That's next year.
If it was anybody's birthday.
So, where do you get your liquid nitrogen? Can you get it on Amazon?
No. What you need to do is, there are a couple of things that you can do. Air gas is one of the larger, in this area, at least, larger gas distributors. And one of the things that makes it really easy is that there are multiple air gas facilities that you can go to. There's one on Vassar Street in Cambridge. They usually have some tanks of liquid nitrogen, so if you only want a little amount, it's costly if you only want a little amount. It's really reasonably priced if you get together with friends and you just rent a container for a month and play. So one of the things that you should do is see if you can find some like-minded people and do that. On the other hand, let me tell you something really, really cheap that we found out, that a lot of times you need a doer. You put the liquid nitrogen in a doer, and doers are mostly incredibly expensive. I mean, anywhere.
A doer flask is like a heavy-duty thermos bottle.
Yep, and there is a place in Waltham called Cambridge Scientific that a lot of times they'll have larger doers that are $300 to $800, which in some ways is a fraction of its cost. But one of the things that you can do is go to a store that has the commercial coffee pumps. Get a 3-4 liter one, and that's insulated enough, but it's not airtight, so you allow the gas to vent. You find someone, you go in with friends, and or you go to the air gas and you fill up the 4 liter.
Last year when we made the ice cream with liquid nitrogen, we just used one of the coffee urns full of nitrogen.
Styrofoam will actually do okay.
Well, yeah, but not for transport.
No,
yeah, it's brittle in transport.
Fran,
so this isn't this. I have. It's not quite a question.
Okay.
I know it's death to say that in a kennel, but So I am authorized by one of the editors of the 50th anniversary Simple Cookbook to present this to you guys. It's not masterful micro cuisine, except for possibly Jim Hines' elf barbecue recipe in the back.
Thank you.
And we will. Okay. I will get these on the Sifu website if you are so interested.
Support. Yes. So one of the things that I'm going to leave you with is something.
To,
go ahead.
About liquid nitrogen, it's really, really,
yes.
Really
safety
dangerous.
Warning. Yes.
Seriously dangerous. Two other ways to get liquid nitrogen, if you have a friend who's a dermatologist. Liquid nitrogen is used to freeze off little skin lesions and tags and things like that, and they can get it in small quantities. If you have a friend who's a welder, that means that they have access to a company like Airgas, can probably just get liquid nitrogen delivered. But no kidding around, if you don't have the proper container, if you don't think you know how to store it, don't. Because most of the liquid nitrogen horror stories are not about people getting burned or hurt by making contact with liquid nitrogen, but by their facilities blowing up because they have improperly stored extremely volatile high-pressure gas.
Note also that if you leave liquid nitrogen in an open bowl with liquid oxygen,
Yes.
Now, what I was going to say is I saw a Kickstarter that I just had to participate in. And unfortunately, because of production delays, I thought it was going to be here. So we'll definitely have it next year. The pancake bot. I don't know if anyone is aware of that.
I saw that.
Yes. So what I'm going to say to you guys, and my email is Diane, D-I-A-N-E, at readercon.org. If you have some patterns or shapes that you're interested in seeing next year, part of the talk, or at least I'll have it out in the hallway, we'll make some shapes and Readercon logos and things like that.
Safe from work.
Work patterns, yes. So feel free over the course of the year, send me some patterns and we'll pick out a couple of them.
Now,
having
experimented at home beforehand to find out that it doesn't take an hour to draw a circle, you know, with this robot.
Like a printer.
Yeah. So that's our blog. That's where we document the experiments. A post just went up yesterday about the step-by-step for making the meat fruit, because why not?
Why not?
I'm going to shut this down just to make sure that we're not delaying the next panel, but we have a few more. We have at least one more minute if anybody else has a question.
Louise.
I just wonder, is there any possibility that this sort of approach to food could possibly, I don't know, help with like distribution of food to places where they've had a disaster or... I mean, for the most part, it sounds like it's just play and it's fun. But it seems like things in cubes and whatnot might be...
There's actually
so
a couple of, I mean, freeze-drying things in cubes means that they are lighter and more flexible. So if you are going on a journey to Mars, for instance, that would be something to think about. The other thing is they just took a 3D printer up into space. And getting a printer like that to work in zero-G is kind of a trick.
Yeah.
So, but the next thing then is you can take the ingredients for food and print in space, because one of the big issues for astronauts is texture. And everything tastes different and texturizes different, but you can make custom space food if you can print it with very low storage ingredients. So that's a big deal.
I was thinking more for, you know, like when they have a tidal wave somewhere and people want food and stuff.
How do you print this? I know how it works with plastic.
Layers.
Oh.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye.